live from New York, it's Ask This Engineer.
Hey everybody, and welcome to another live edition of Ask an Engineer. It's me, Lady Ada, the engineer, and with me is Mr. Lady Ada on camera control, and also streamer, and also typer, and also the person who's gonna come up with the quiz question. So be nice to him.
A lot of pressure.
Yeah. A lot of stuff depends on this man. Okay, so we got an exciting show tonight. We got some fun new products. We got a lot of news, videos, updates, and more. Why don't we just roll right into it?
We will do that. On tonight's show, the code is Laura. 10% all the way up to 11:59 p.m. Eastern Time tonight. We'll tell you why the code is Laura. That's L-O-R-A. Everything except for gift certificates and software. Show and tell, people around the world showing and sharing their projects and more. Packet the mailbag is going to stop by. We're going to read your letters to us. Help Wanted, the Adafruit Jobs Board, the best place online to share your skills. And if you're a company who wants to get a cool maker to work with you, this is where you post it up. Time travel, look back in the world of hackers, makers, artists, engineers, pioneers, and more. 3D printing, cool videos from Noah and Pedro this week. We've got some new products. We're going to answer your question. We're going to have some top secret stuff.
Ooh.
We're going to give away something with a trivia question. All that and more on Ask an Engineer.
Yay, we've been doing this for over 67, I don't even know, many years.
It's going to be...
8 years?
Yeah, like 8 years or something.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, right. And what we're finding out now from our show and tell is many people around the world who do electronics are starting to broadcast.
Yes.
And they're going to be broadcasting on Twitch and Facebook Live and all that, and we'll get to
that tonight. I can't wait until we have like a... it's like we can constantly turn on Twitch or Facebook video and always be watching people make stuff.
Most of us who do electronics and like to build things have decided this is the year, because why watch all the political nightmares
it's
on TV?
It's because of all the debates. There's too many debates.
There's a debate every 7 seconds.
Town halls,
there's
debates.
A town hall every 7 seconds.
I'm
so we have to make sure there's an equal representation of people doing electronics.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So again, code Laura. 10% off. That's true. That's how we pay the bills here, how we keep doing these videos and more.
Wait, but do you mean we are not venture funded?
No.
We have no investment?
No.
There's no, like, Koch brothers or, like,
no.
Money bags?
No, what's interesting is,
Paying our way?
Yeah, so I'm in all the interviews for the staff here, and when people interview at Adafruit, they always say, this is neat, like the people who run the company, Lady Ada, myself, and you know the collection of team leads and directors that we have, they're all there, or some of them are for the interview, of course. And a lot of people have worked for companies for like 10 years and they've never met the people who run it.
They may never meet their
and
boss.
They never, and they keep them away from ever being able to ask any questions or like, how can we make improvements and how can we do that? So it's kind of cool. There is,
yeah.
It's just you, Lady Ada.
No, it's actually pretty common.
The Lady Ada stops here.
You never meet... I've worked for companies and I never met the owner of the company. Everyone hangs out. We all hang out on Fridays.
Yeah. So, anyways, some stuff. Same day, New York City. If you place an order before 11 a.m. and your zip code is one of the ones that we cover in Manhattan, you can get same day delivery. We're just like the Googles and the Amazons.
A nice person will come here.
Yeah.
They're permitted to come here. We'll have their package
ready for
them.
Yeah, we have a deal with a same-day service.
We have a deal. They'll come in, they'll pick it up, and they'll deliver it to you.
Yeah. Okay.
You don't even have to get on the train. You don't even have to leave your house.
If you are in the continental U.S., orders $200 or more, get free UPS Ground. That's happening, like, right now. This is Ask an Engineer, programming note, 8 p.m. every week. Show and tell every week, 7:30. You saw that, hopefully. This is part of the Adafruit Live series that we do every week here. The Facebook...
Live.
Keynote was yesterday, and you know, we really didn't have a bunch of stuff to do with Facebook because it was just like people from high school we didn't want to see. But they've recently added a bunch of stuff, and through acquisition and through more properties that they have.
This Instagram is owned by Facebook. I didn't even know that.
Instagram's been owned by Facebook for a while. It was big. It was a big deal.
They really don't make that very clear.
It was big news.
I know.
You follow Maker Business, not.
Oh, that's right. I remember it was because it was sold for one Instagram. But I forgot.
It's a unit of measure.
Because usually they make them rebrand, but they didn't with Instagram.
No. And it's unclear what's going to happen with all these different things. But anyways, Instagram is part of Facebook.
I just forgot.
They got WhatsApp. Now they have Facebook Live video. We're broadcasting to Facebook Live right now.
Okay.
The other thing that they have is VR. We do VR stuff. They had a drone at this event. And what's funny is they're talking about chatbots. And do you remember the MakeBot I made at Make Magazine? you would add it to your buddy list, and you would talk to it. It was an aimbot, and it used this thing called like Smarter Agent, and then I had this other person I worked with.
I thought it was IRC bots.
All sorts of bots. And anyways, they're adding that, and there's this AI world and home automation. Anyways, it's really neat. And if you're a broadcaster like we are, it's like little check boxes. So we have all these things going. So anyways, I thought that was cool.
So we can now broadcast through the system that we had that uses Wirecast, and we have these like lovely cameras and lights and stuff, and multiple, you know, the overhead cam and the face cam and whatever cam, and like controls, so we can broadcast to Ustream, YouTube Live, Twitch, and Facebook. And how many are we broadcasting to right now?
How many people are probably watching it live?
How many of those four?
All of them.
All four networks. Okay.
Yeah, and then Periscope too.
Periscope is the only one that doesn't go through Wirecast.
Periscope not yet. Okay. And that's interesting because like as the developer world is moving towards APIs again, Twitter doesn't allow you to pump a video stream to your Twitter account and have it come out of Periscope, where Facebook Live does do that right now.
They do now, yeah.
Right now, as of yesterday, you can give a drone your Facebook credentials and stream from a drone. It's neat. So anyways.
Tony DeCole was talking about how, like, because there's so many streaming services, and eventually Periscope might join, that we eventually have to have some service where you stream one stream and it splits it for you into all four, because it's actually hard to stream to four services at once without, like, Fios, or, like, we have, you know, a pretty intense pipe here. We have, like, 200 up, 200 down. But most people don't, so like they're stuck streaming only one server. Anyways, it's
so
multicast.
Yeah,
we're back to where
insidery baseball stuff right now for us. Okay, so we had some Desk of Gladiators this week. This is our live show that we do from your desk. Sometimes it's at the factory, sometimes it's at your bedroom desk. Lady Ada, what was on Desk of Gladiators this week?
Okay, so last night, I think it was last night, I did low power Feather 32.4 radio. So I was basically experimenting with. Like the radios I'm going to be talking about today, the Feather RFM radios and the Laura radios, putting them in sleep mode and using a Monsoon power monitor, which is a lovely high precision power monitor, to track how much current is being used and how to get the 32.4 radio to the lowest power. So I got it down from 40 milliamps to, if I don't listen, if I turn off the radio, I got it down to like, I think, I stopped listening and got it down to 30, and then I turned the radio off between transmits and I got it down to 10. And then by putting the RF, the Feather and the radio to sleep, I got it down to 300 microamperes. And then it turned out that it's actually really hard to get lower than that because there's just peripherals that are on, like they're keeping the system from like completely turning off. The 300 microamperes is pretty good. And so I added that to the tutorial today, which is why I was doing it last night. I also did a circuit playground check-in. I showed what happens if your PCB house deletes mask between pads and just what to watch out for when that happens. I just got to show that on the microscope and also talked about me getting a ham radio license again. I'm going to re-up my license because it expired. And then I showed off a huge batch of like 10 prototyping PCBs that came in, about half of them already assembled and sent for fab. And then I also did a little tutorial on controlling USB devices. In this case, it was the CP2104. It's a Scilabs USB serial converter. And it's GPIO that you can control with USB control sequences. And this is covered in this awesome book that I'll be talking about in a bit. You can use Python to send raw USB commands. And it's a very handy hacker technique that it's good to have if you ever want to control USB devices without writing your own kernel driver.
Okay, and then we had Watch Tony's D-Disc, and on Tony's shows this week, there was the Raspberry Pi and Python Internet of Things Part 4, the fake Periscope you walked around, the Seattle Comic Con, and then MicroPython on the Feather.
Yep, an update.
Yeah, and it was an update. So
yeah, he did it a year ago, he's doing it again, and he showed how to do the new version and all the new updated capabilities, so pretty cool. A lot of stuff has been added. They just did a Kickstarter, we partnered with them. To make sure it all worked on the Feather Huzzah, which they said was a great platform, and MicroPython is a great pair.
Yeah, so we got a lot going on. And then this, let's see, was it last night or was it Monday? Anyways, it was one of these days. We had the third episode of Pseudo Random. It's a new show with Colin.
That was yesterday.
It could have been. And it's been one long day for me. And we talked about color organs. A couple stills from it. It's a 20-minute long show where we explore what color organs are, and more, and kind of beautiful stuff on the show and tell. C. Scott showed off and talked about kind of Sears back in the day, where you would go in and or a Radio Shack, and there'd be all these interesting, colorful things to play sound.
I wonder why they went out of style.
I think they're coming. Everything comes back.
I think they should come back. They're cool.
Colin created this amazing music video that go. It was in Pseudo Random Show, and then we also have these videos that we play. So here is some music from the stylings of Colin. Okay, well, you can watch the whole entire thing with Lady Ada and Colin. It's on youtube.com/adafruit. You can also check it on our site and all that. Okay. Next up, Lady Ada, show and tell.
Yes.
People around the world showing and sharing their projects every week. What did they show this week?
All right, we had Tony D, who had a really, really awesome members-only jacket. He's really into members-only jackets, and he's got a collection. And this one is a green and yellow and blue. It's cool. It's vintage 70s. It was only jacket or 80s. I wasn't around for these, but they look great. He also went to Emerald Comic Con, and he did a stream. We talked about that. He also took a lot of photos. Just kind of checked out what was going on at Emerald City. Looks like it was a really fun time, so good on him. He also did a stream on Monday on the ESP 8266 MicroPython. We talked about that. He's going to be doing a couple more streams, maybe about MicroPython, maybe tomorrow or the next day, so check in on that. Noah and Pedro had a preview of their next 3D printed project. This week they're doing a little milling video, take a break from 3D printing, and they're going to basically build kind of like an on-air sign like this. This is our Internet of Things on-air sign that turns on automatically whenever Adafruit's Twitch streaming, so they're going to be making a 3D printed version, so you don't have to buy this thing and mod it. So that's kind of cool. And then Simon came in, and he's a 3D designer, and he worked with Noah and Pedro to make an Overwatch tracer gun with NeoPixels and LEDs and Bluetooth control, and it looked really cool. And Lottie came in, gave us an update. PCBs came in. PCBs weren't super successful, But learning a lot, learning how to put sockets into PCBs to change out subcomponent boards. It's a process. Lon is doing lots of streaming on Twitch. I'm going to subscribe, and maybe I'll watch some of his Twitch streams. He made a really cool toolbox caddy with recycled cardboard and some PVC pipes that he'll use when he's doing streaming to clear off his desk really quickly. It's got a fan. It's got a soldering station. It's got a bunch of tools. Just a really cute toolbox caddy. And he also made an illuminated figurine for a Blizzard character. I think it was a Blizzard character. I don't know, some video game that I haven't played. And it's one of the videos that he's streamed. It's a project that he did a stream about, so that's kind of neat. And then C-Scott came in and just like wowed us with color organs aplenty. It is color organ week here. I mean, we're just gonna be doing this forever.
Yeah.
I'm down with that.
We talked about Sears.
Sears and the music, the Atari video music.
Yeah.
I don't even know what it's called. And he showed a color organ he made when he was 14. And he opened it up and he wondered aloud why he wasn't dead yet, because it's just like 120 volt mains wires. I mean, like in America, 120 volts, it's not going to kill you.
No big deal.
It'll give you a little bit of a shock. But when you're 14, I think you're young enough, you can handle it. I think your heart's strong. This is why we don't have as many older makers, maybe. It's because they didn't make it past the color
organ. Survivor bias.
Survivor bias.
Yeah.
I'm just kidding. And they made a version in 1984, which was a lot better. It had fuses. It had a circuit board. It wasn't just like wires like twisted around and connected. He actually did a very nice, much safer job. But either way, it's pretty amazing that every time I look at a DIY color organ, it's always pretty shocking.
Okay.
They're simple to make, but also very simple to make very dangerous. So, an awesome time was had by all. If anybody here has color organs, come by Show and Tell and show them off.
We're calling it. This is color organ appreciation month.
Yeah.
Sounds really bad now that I.
Okay, so you guys want to show your color organ on the Show and Tell?
Yeah.
Very easy. Go to a Google Plus page at plus.google.com/+Adafruit.
Right.
At 7:30 p.m. Eastern Time every Wednesday, so about 45 minutes from now if you're watching live. Every 7:30 p.m., just wait, and we're going to post a link. And then click the link to join in, have your webcam and your microphone muted and everything ready to go ahead of time, please. Take a couple minutes to demo your project.
Yeah.
And it's fun times had by all, but please know it does fill up quickly, so be ready and clicky.
I am Philip Quickly. Help participants in the Show and Tell get an as seen on the Show and Tell sticker. If you're on the Show and Tell tonight, email support@adafruit.com, and we will send you out a sticker. Mailbag. This is Packed Mailbag. Every week at Adafruit, we have an all-company meeting. We call it State of the Fruit. We read these emails, these posts, these letters from you. Here's one we've either read or reading this week. I just want to congratulate Adafruit for their fast sales and shipping. I ordered stuff yesterday afternoon and it's scheduled for delivery this afternoon. No special shipping, UPS Ground. I'm completely satisfied with the quality of your products and customer service. I'm only one state away, but the response time gets high bar for your competitors. Again, thanks, Smart Guy. Thank you, Smart Guy. Very nice of you. Okay. Up on it. This is the Adafruit Jobs Board. We started adafruit.com/jobs because we just saw a ton of like scammy, sketchy job boards out there. And we thought, well, for makers,
they
deserve better. They can post their skills, and we can just look at it real quick, make sure it's not a scam or spam. And if it's a company, we can make sure it's not like multi-level marketing scam or whatever, which is like whatever.
For resistors?
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff. And then there's all these jobs boards in the world where they trick you to apply, and then they use that for identity theft.
Yeah,
like,
oh,
just give us
happens.
Your social security number, and we'll give you a job.
Yeah, you apply for the job. Give us your name, address, phone number, social security number. Current and past addresses, and before you know it,
all your information to steal your identity. So, anyways, so we started the adafruit.com/jobs board so people could post neat jobs. This is a cloud infrastructure engineer from Fictiv, and I believe they're a hardware company. I think I remember linking to that hardware report, and it was from them. But basically, this is someone who is a cloud infrastructure architecture, which basically means you're doing stuff with Amazon AWS all the time. That's what it really means. So if that's something that's interesting to you, you're in California, check it out. It's on jobs board. Cloud is just another name for someone else's computer.
That's true.
Okay. next. Speaking of,
it's
yeah.
Nimbus,
see, I line these up. Yeah,
cloud character.
Yeah, so this is our little happy cloud entity called Nimbus that it wants all your data. It wants all of your Internet of Things
devices.
It's keeping
it safe.
So we have this service. It's in beta. It's Adafruit.io, and it's our Internet of Things for makers, and it's from Adafruit, so it's good.
Yeah.
We have an Adafruit.io update. So I get to use all these graphics. Todd and team, Justin, Tyler, and everyone's working on this. So this week, we have 3 million inserts of log data. Sorry, 30 million of log data for the last 7 days. 10,000 users, about 7,000 online feeds, 50 inserts per second with MQTT, and 5 inserts with the REST API. We did some load testing, and we're able to handle more traffic, so that's good. Todd also did some testing with us with the new radios.
Yes, he did.
And
thank you so much.
Yeah, and so this is what we figured out. When I say we, I mean Todd. So he was testing your new Feather LoRa radios with Adafruit.io, so he's able to take a new product and do logging on Adafruit.io to test and see how far it can go. So he got 1.27 miles away, not line of sight, with
just like walking around
in central Maryland, and you can see he used our services and your hardware all together to make a cool project. So
yep.
That's it. That's Adafruit.io testing the products, and the products made for Adafruit.io.
Yeah. No. It's we eat the dog food, as it were, or we pet the cat, and whatever the phrase is. You know, one of the reasons I wanted to do LoRa is because, and we'll talk about it more, but people were starting to do projects with Adafruit.io, and there were a couple people who were saying, like, well, I have to have data go far away, but I don't want to get involved in cellular because I have a bunch of these and I don't want to get a SIM card. And so when you want to have, you know, and LoRa radios are a little expensive, but you don't have to deal with, like, they're much lower power than cellular. They can wake up, send a packet, go to sleep. You don't have to keep connections or worry about, like, paying your cell phone bill. And these radios can go very, very far. And they're great for the people that have contacted us that are doing rural sensing or agricultural sensing. And, you know, they're like, the farm is really big, so, like, the rice fields are over there, and the farmhouse is over here, and I want to be able to send data back and forth. So these radios are perfect for that. And so thanks, Todd, for helping debug it. But we're always looking for more suggestions of ways that we can add technologies to Adafruit.io. So LoRa is one of them, and we're going to definitely be showing how to do a LoRa gateway at some point, maybe using an ESP 8266 where we use that to funnel packets back and forth between Adafruit.io, or maybe like Ethernet, whatever, all sorts of options for funneling packet data between.
Okay. If you have a drone or you know someone who's taking photos or you saw a cool video shot with a drone, enter the dronies. Still have a couple more months. Adafruit.com/dronies. Next up, learn.adafruit.com. How many tutorials do you think you have?
Yeah, like 965-ish.
Yes, correct.
Okay, great.
Okay, which ones did people publish this week?
So this week, well, we have the LoRa Feather radio tutorial. So that's very similar to the one that's over there that says the 3284 radio. We had a tutorial from Aaron St. Blaine, the CyberWig Pixie wearable Wi-Fi LED visualization, which you might be thinking like, it's just some like crazy LED
I have a video
thing.
To show.
But by the way, this is one of the most technically complicated projects we've done. This is a wig that has a Wi-Fi module, a Cortex M0 with Wi-Fi module in it. And it is using DMA to control dot star LEDs in the wig and receive streamed video data from a computer over Wi-Fi that has processing or electric sheep running, you know, in the background. So the wig itself is dynamically updating, so it displays whatever is on the computer screen real live time, and it works really, really well. So this is an update of the .star DMA stuff that we've been doing with the M0 and Lightship code that Phil B did. But this is pretty intense. Like, this is not like generating random LEDs that happen to match the display. This is whatever is on your computer screen is on your cosplay.
Yeah. I remember about 10 years ago when I said, I just want to wear Blade Runner.
Like we're actually getting there.
To me, that was the whole point of the maker movement. Was let's just get to the, as soon as we can wear Blade Runner, then like let's go work on something else. Maybe we'll do biohacking. But like we're getting really close.
We're getting really close.
Yeah. Okay.
We should have.
Is there anything else you want to share before I show the video?
Jeremy Blythe, that screenshot is like exactly when the screen is white. Wow. But it's actually kind of a neat project. He uses two Raspberry Pis, and one has a Pi camera on it, and it's streaming the video data and temperature to Adafruit I/O, and then another Pi is displaying it on a Pi TFT with the temperature overlaid on it. So you basically have like a DIY like Nest or Dropcam. But it uses two Raspberry Pis and Adafruit IO, so you don't have to have a separate service. And it can overlay data onto the display. So, you know, what a temperature or the current time or, you know, any other notifications that you want. So he's using this to monitor the outside of his house with temperature and motion. It's kind of neat. It's like you can do video camera stuff over Adafruit IO.
Okay. I'm going to play this video of the wig thing. All right?
Yeah, totally should. It's a great video.
Learn.adafruit.com this week. Okay, next up, time travel. Zooming right along. Look back in the world of makers, hackers, artists, engineers, pioneers. Often now, people that you may have not heard of, but you should have. So, happy birthday, Evelyn Berzin. Hope I'm pronouncing it okay. Born 1925, American computer scientist. Here's the thing about Evelyn, and I'm really sad that I didn't know Evelyn, like it was like Grace Hopper, like every time there's like computer science, people say Grace Hopper, but I didn't have her name. I remember kind of hearing about her, and I think we wrote about her a long time ago, but she certainly wasn't on the tip of my tongue when I think about the history of computers. She just got inducted in the Computer Museum in 2015, but she's an American computer designer, best known for designing the first computer-driven word processor. She also designed the first computer-controlled system for airline reservations.
That's pretty handy.
Okay, this is a big deal.
That's funny. She had the idea for a word processor to simplify the work of secretaries.
Yeah. So, studied physics. She worked at...
And she was sold to Burroughs.
Yeah, okay. and kind of one of the pioneers, you know, like doing reservation systems.
She developed the first computerized banking system.
Yeah.
And it had a 1 second response time. In 1957, that's pretty good.
So when I log into Chase, it takes like 15 minutes to get anything done.
PayPal takes...
She'd send this 91-year-old woman over there to fix Chase. So anyways, she has this neat quote. Achieving a goal provides immediate satisfaction. The process of achieving a goal is a lasting pleasure. So she's 91. She's still alive. She's in New York. And she has a place somewhere in like upstate New York, I believe. But what an amazing person that you just don't hear about a lot. So it's on our site. And Evelyn, if anyone knows Evelyn, I'd love to get a hold of her and just send her some questions. She'd probably answer in a second. Apparently that's her thing.
Sorry, why?
But
response time is
in 1976, Business Week magazine named her the 10 most senior businesswomen in the United States, and she was the only woman who was president of a technical company then, named Redactron. It was a maker of word processors. She basically replaced like the office computer too. Anyways, it'd be really cool if more people knew about her. So, cool stuff.
Okay.
Amazing.
They had to design their own chips. Because they didn't exist at the time.
Yeah, there was no chips.
Yeah.
probably designed a computer, and she's like, oh man, I need a chip. What's a chip? Well, I don't know. I gotta make it.
Yeah, she designed the passenger reservation system for United Airlines. Delivered in about 1962. 1962, they had an automatic. I'm actually surprised that early that they had an automatic.
It's incredible.
I mean, everybody else was still using typewriters.
Yeah. Okay. Pretty Printing this week with Noah and Pedro. They have a few videos. We're going to show them all. Here's the MIDI box. And then last week you had a preview of using the other mill to etch an iPhone, and now we have the full how-to video. So here we go.
Today we're going to take a look at using the other mill and see if we can etch on the back of an iPhone. So we had this basic idea. We haven't seen other people do it with the other mill. We've seen a bunch of people on YouTube do it with a laser engraver, but we kind of haven't seen it done with a CNC mill, so that's what we're gonna try to do today. First thing I need to do is sort of measure this up using some digital calipers. We're gonna input that into Other Planner, and then we're gonna use this engraving bit that I just got from Other Machine. And we're gonna see if this works. I don't know if it's gonna work, so let's find out. All right, so this is it all set up. I have selected anodized aluminum, and I set a custom size with all the measurements we just got. So the next thing we need to do now is to just get a design. So I'm thinking what we're gonna do is use Sparky, the blue smoke monster. Y'all probably know about Sparky. He's a little noid of electronics. And the first thing I need to do is sort of make him into a vector graphic. So what I'll do is I'll trace him out in Photoshop, and I'll bring him into Illustrator, and then I will make it into SVG. It comes in a little big, so the cool thing is inside of Other Planner, you can rotate it if you want, and you can also change the scale. And then I like this feature here where it says align to material. You can set it to the center of the material. Because if you look at the iPhone, there's like a little bit of room here in the center here. Actually, that's where all the space is, because you got the Apple logo here and then all this text and stuff. So we're going to try to do it in the center here, and hopefully that works out. So that's going to be it right there. I think 0.6 of a scale looks fine. And for the actual bit, we're not going to use any of the flat ends. We're going to use an engraving tool. So I'll cut out of that. And then Other Mill will figure out all the tool paths for it. And we're not going to do a cutout, so I'll deselect cutout and just do the engraving. And then we can do all the little eyes and stuff and all the extra details. So I think that'll look pretty cool. So the next thing we're going to do is put some tape, some double stick tape on this guy. And this is sort of a broken iPhone. So you can see we got a cracked screen there just because, you know, we don't want to mess up our It's a good test, so let's go ahead and do that. Maybe do three. I guess three will do it. All right, let's put this on the other mill. Okay, I already hit the load button, so the spoiler plate is right there. And I gotta make sure that the orientation is set right, so it's gonna be that way. And you have to align it so that it's flush, and you have to align it on the lower left bottom corner here. So I'm gonna try to be as flush as I can. And then once I got it in a, once I get it in a good spot, I'm just gonna press it down. Tell me when.
Yep.
All right, so I'm gonna change the bit. This is a 0.7 millimeter end mill. This is my engraving bit. It comes with a little cover here. You can see it. See, it's like it's just a pointy tip. It's not like a flat end mill like this one. It's an engraving bit, so that's the difference there. All right, so I'm just gonna put that in there, see if it fits. Yeah, it fits. Ah, it's perfect, yeah. All right, I guess that'll work. I'll put it back in there. Now I'll hit over here in the software. We'll hit continue, we remove the tool, and now I'm gonna hit unknown tool and change it to engraving tool. And it even looks like that too, so I'll hit okay. And what it'll do now is it's gonna home itself and then just do a double check to make sure that it's in the right spot. So it's like, okay, verify your tool position. Looks good, hit continue. And then it's gonna say, is that in the safe zone? And it's a little bit down, so I'm gonna bring it up a bit. Yeah, that looks good, and I'll hit locate. So now it's gonna go down, and then it'll keep going until it barely touches the spoiler plate. So now it's located itself, and hopefully it doesn't crash into the iPhone. If it does, I'm gonna hit this big red button here. So we're pretty much ready to mill. I'm gonna go ahead and put the cover back on. Material's loaded, bit is loaded, SVG's loaded. I'm pretty scared. You guys ready? Definitely do my iPhone. I would put my name on it, my Noah name. All right, so here it is, Sparky the Blue Monster. This thing came out pretty good. We're really surprised how well this turned out. Using the engraving bit was definitely the way to go, and making sure that we sort of eased our way into it incrementally really helped out, so I didn't just drive into the phone. So really cool. I hope you guys enjoyed this one, and we'll check you guys out later. And let us know if you guys have any ideas. If you want to see us mill like on a block of cheese or something, let us know and we'll give it a shot. But yeah, there it is. There's Sparky, the blue monster, the blue smoke monster. Also, be sure to check out the other mill if you guys want to pick one up. It's in the Adafruit shop. And you can also get the engraver from the other machine company. So there you guys have it. Until next time, remember to keep on milling.
And that, folks, is how the FBI got into the iPhone. They drilled into it with Noah and Pedro.
Turns out, that's all you gotta do.
The other mill actually will unlock any iPhone.
Yeah. Doesn't mean you get the data out of it.
That's right. Okay, we have one more 3D video. It's Time-Lapse Tuesday with Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Who's your favorite Ninja Turtle?
Leonardo?
Yeah. Okay. forget, tomorrow is 3D Thursday, and there is 3D Hangouts and a variety of 3D printing shows. I have some, not breaking news, but news.
News.
Yeah, news. I think I put this in our Maker Business newsletter. We have a newsletter at Adafruit Daily. No spam. It just is like business stuff.
You should totally sign up.
Yeah. I think I sent this out, but if I didn't, anyways. On Apple.com, and Apple.com, the European site for Apple, they're selling 3D printers. Ultimaker is now for sale on Apple.com. 3D printers are for sale on Apple. This is incredible.
Yeah.
This is such big news. Just a few years ago, it was for sure that it was going to be like MakerBot one day. For sure. For sure they're going to be in the Apple store one day.
They did a deal with Microsoft. It was not too surprising.
Something was going to happen. This is like the personal computer. That's what everyone was saying. And what's interesting is Ultimaker, which we stock, is now kind of the emerging or the winner in this makerspace for 3D printers.
Mm-hmm.
Anyways.
Good for them.
Yeah, so it's in there. You can search around and you can see the story.
I think when they went assembled and they maintained the quality. They always had the highest quality. So it's not too surprising that they used that to fund development to...
Yeah, so anyways, cool stuff.
To win the market.
Lady Ada, before we go to the new products, Coded Laura. Some of the stuff we're running out of, so if you're all going to buy it, you should probably buy it soon.
Yes.
Okay, ready?
Okay.
Here it is.
I know there's a song, but yeah, I just can't help
all right.
it.
Okay, what's this?
This is a jigging kit for the other mill. It's a precision fixturing clamp, and I believe it was even used in Noam Pedro's video. But it has these like little alignment clamps and toes, and so you can, instead of taping things down, you can fixture them in place and clamp them down into the bed of the other mill, which has screw mount holes, so you can basically attach them. So I'm going to take this home because I actually want this for the other mill we have at home, especially if you're milling metals. Oh yeah, can you hide us?
Yes, if you have another mill in your apartment like we do.
Like we do. And if you want to mill stuff and you don't want to, and you, especially if you want to do double-sided boards and get the alignment perfect, this will give you that perfect alignment that you want. And you can see that you can slide little toes in and clamp them down and clamp down your material extremely well. So it's a very good accessory for once you got your other mill and you really want to fixture things really strongly, especially metals that if you want to mill them because it's a little tougher on the bit, you don't want them to vibrate.
Okay, next up, USB complete. It's a book. It's good.
This is a great book. This is one of my favorite technical books by Jan Axelsen, who wrote a bunch of books on different protocols, but this is the best book on USB. Even if you are just using a USB bootloader or a mass storage device or HID and you're using a library, it's still really, really handy to read this. It just has all the details about USB internals, and there's a lot of specifics you need to know. And I referenced this on the video that we did where we talked to a USB device with raw control packets. I learned how to do that by reading USB complete and then, referencing what I learned from that to the Python code. I read this back when it was like second edition. Now it's fifth edition. It has USB 3.1. I realized that I lent out my book and I didn't have a copy anymore. And then I was like, well, you know what? We should actually be carrying this book. And so I picked up a couple copies. It's a really great, it's good for anybody who does anything with USB. You don't have to be developing a low level peripheral or host controller. You still want to know this stuff.
Okay, next up. Some teensy like stuff.
This is prop shields, prop wings, prop add-ons for the Teensy 3.2 and 3.1 and LC. These are handy little add-on boards. So this is designed essentially for props, but I can count for anything you want. And I'll show this on the overhead, I think. So you get your Teensy 3.2, for example, and there's two versions. So let me get this open. So this basically you would solder this on to here, and there's two versions. There's this version that has these chips in place. They don't have the LEDs, that's right. It has this accelerometer and magnetometer and gyroscope and temperature and barometric pressure sensor, altitude sensor. And this version doesn't. It doesn't have the temperature, barometric pressure, accelerometer, gyroscope, or magnetometer. So it's a lot less expensive because those are quite expensive sensors. But if you want something that has a lot of sensors on it, grab this one. And if you just want the other accessories, grab this one. So that's the difference. But both of them have a 2-watt amplifier, and it uses the I think it uses the DAC output, so it's mono, but you get 2 watts output, probably class D amplifier. It has an 8 megabyte flash, SPI flash storage, which is very handy if you want to store audio or sensor data in it, either reading out or storing. And it has 2 5-volt output pins, so that's really good for driving NeoPixels or dot star LEDs, anything that needs 5-volt or prefers 5-volt input or output to it. And then, yeah, you just plug your Teensy on top and you solder it in place. And it's kind of like an all-in-one. It's kind of interesting because I'm designing a lot of wings, and I'm like, this is an interesting idea. It has kind of all the things you want for a lot of projects if you want data storage, or audio playback, amplifier, only mono, but that's good enough for most people, and full tendoff sensing for motion. And this uses a chipset I've never used before. It's from NXP Freescale, and I didn't even know that Freescale made accelerometers, magnetometers, or gyroscopes, but apparently they do, which I had not seen the Freescale. I've seen, like, you know, all these other different brands, but Freescale now has them, Freescale/NXP, and they also wrote and released a fusion sensor fusion code that apparently does a pretty good job of orientation. And that might be an interesting, these are fairly inexpensive chips. They're only like $3 altogether. So it's a very good alternative to the BNO055, which has fusion, but it's built in. This you put it on the chip, but there's code available for both like 8-bit processors and like 32-bit processors. So you get like the kind of like super fancy and not so fancy version, and I'd like to try that out because I've never. It's kind of cool that NXP.
Someone's interested in a new chip.
I'm interested in this new chip because if they released calibration, because like you never get that. Yeah. Usually you have
to. So what you're saying is, if you're a chip manufacturer and you want a lot of people to use your stuff, what do you got to do?
You should probably release some sort of documentation that's not under NDA.
Yeah.
Okay. Because if you get, there's some chips where they have fusion data, they'll give you orientation output, but you have to sign all sorts of documents. Anyways,
okay, so we got,
sorry, that was a rant.
So did you show both of them?
I did. So you had this one, which doesn't have the chips.
No, this one.
A little less expensive, but really handy. So you have the power of the Teensy 3.2, and then you get all these awesome accessories to make cosplay props or anything that makes audio or projects that just do things.
Okay.
And you've got this super powerful Cortex M4 as well.
All right, next up. Cable.
It's just a cable, but it's a pretty cool cable.
Yeah.
So this cable, and I'll show it when I do the demo later, but it has one micro USB input and 2 micro USB outputs. Yeah. And one of the outputs is power only. That's the shorter cable. And one is power plus data. So it's kind of a handy way if you have one micro USB, like charging cable, you can use it for data. You know, you can use one for sync and data, and charge, and one for charge. It's good for like Raspberry Pis and stuff where you might want to use one power adapter and then use it to power both a display or like NeoPixels or something and also the Pi itself.
I'll tell you the application that I want.
Yeah.
And this finally solves it. So I have a hotspot, one of these like little portable Wi-Fi things.
Mm-hmm.
And when you plug it in to charge it, it like turns on and it shows up as a hard drive and like all of a sudden
everything.
That's
right, you can select which one you want. Yeah.
Yeah, so I don't like that. I just want to charge it.
Yeah.
But for a phone or something else, I want it to be data. I want it to go through USB. So this is perfect for that. Some devices, please don't ever want, I don't want you to ever talk to my computer, ever.
That's true. This is one of, this is like those, like the USB condoms. But it's like you get a choice. You just use the long cable. That's what they're called.
I don't want devices to talk to my computer unless they think it's okay. I just want to charge them.
But yeah, so you use the short cable when you just want to charge, no data syncing, and the long one when you want to do data syncing as well as charging.
Yeah.
So it's good for, like, you can choose one or the other or both. Anyways, a person emailed and suggested it, and I was like, this is actually
a
pretty good idea for a cable. Very handy.
Okie dokie.
I'm using it right now to power these two demos.
Okay. And then the star of the show, besides you this week, is the Feather LoRa. What is this thing?
This is another generation of Feather. So this is the Feather 32U4. It's our kind of a pseudo standard for small battery powered microcontrollers. This uses an Atmega 32U4, same chip that's on the Flora, Arduino, Leonardo, Arduino Micro. has battery charging built in, has built-in USB with bootloader. It works great with the Arduino IDE. And we have a little bit of space left over, and so we usually put some sort of Wi-Fi or Bluetooth module. And this time we're putting in a LoRa radio. So that little green board, which is over there, is a LoRa radio. It's a Semtech 1272 LoRa radio on a module that's made by Hope RF. They just add the analog components. And it's just really neat. It's just a new kind of radio technology, which uses a sort of a spread spectrum, a broad, you know, sort of a spectrum of, it sends the data over multiple frequencies. And I guess the way they encode it or the way they transmit it, I actually don't know the details, allows it to go much, much further than most FSK data, where it just switches between two frequencies. Because this is switching through multiple frequencies, it can go much, much further. So we saw did a demo in Maryland with with Todd.
It can work with Adafruit IO.
And he went 1.2 miles. So that's pretty standard. I've noticed it goes about one and a half miles in city or kind of hilly. If you use with just basic wire antenna, if you're using directional antennas and you tweak the settings to be retransmit and use maybe slower data rates, you can. I saw one person who reported they got up to 20 kilometers. So it is possible. This is something we're going to be trying out with a balloon to see, can you basically use a 20 dBm radio and listen from not space, not even near space, but as it's falling, you can still track it. These are very cool radios. They're a lot more expensive because they're patented. The technology is patented. And so you're not going to, even though it's published how it works to get these chips, you have to pay a lot more for the licensing. So these are licensed LoRa radios, but they are quite neat and they go very, very, very far, and they work great in urban environments too. We walked around and we got 3/4 mile up cross blocks, so the signal had to be bouncing off of multiple buildings to get to us, but we were able to get it from 3/4 mile away in a very busy urban environment. So we have the normal RFM 900 megahertz and 433 radios, and then the LoRa version.
Okay.
You can't use them to talk to each other. Yeah, but you can get one of each or decide which ones you want. So this is our demo. So I'm using that cable to charge both of these up, but they're charged, so I can unplug them. Okay. So both of them have a LoRa radio, and this is the Feather with a OLED side by side, and then this has the Feather with the OLED on top of it. So that's the radio underneath. And I have cute little wire antennas. You can add a UFL connector if you want to have a larger antenna. But for this simple demo, the really neat thing is this works from within the elevator. I had this transmitting and we were in the elevator and I was still getting signal. So it's pretty cool. And then I just have it so when I press the little buttons on here, it shows up over there. It says I pressed button A, B, and C. And then if I go here and press button A, B, and C, shows up over
this could be
here.
A mile away.
But imagine that this was up to 20 kilometers away. That's pretty much the deal, depending on your antenna and how directional you are. But this is for the about 120 milliamps of current that is being drawn. You can go very far. You get quite a bit of distance. And you can set the gain on these as well to be much lower. So given that you have so much link budget or whatever, if you are able to talk to the other radio you want and without any difficulty, you can always lower the amount of current you're using. You can pare down the amplifier to use less current. So, at total utter sleep mode, 300 microamps, peak transmit about 10 milliseconds, 120 milliamps, but you can get down to maybe 30 or 40 milliamps transmit if you don't mind having the transmit be 13 dBm instead of 20.
Total, utter sleep mode.
Yeah, it's just totally asleep.
Yeah.
Not transmitting, not receiving, just chilling. But these are great. So this is, we're going to have another radio that's much, much bigger, but 20 dBm is the limit for a lot of, I've noticed it's a lot of ISM bands prefer you stick to about 20 dBm or less, I think. So these are great, super easy, 900 megahertz for 900 megahertz and 868 for USA and European ISM bands, and then 433 for European ISM bands or amateur radio.
All right, good work, Lady Ada. That was the new products for the week. Good job. All right. Okay, anything that's in stock that you just saw, you can use the code Laura.
The Lauras are in stock. We get a lot of signups.
A little bit left.
Because it's coming soon, but we still have a couple left. They are fancy, and you can get 10% off.
Everybody's favorite segment is here. It's top secret. Don't ask. It's not out yet. This week. I have one, and then you have one.
Yeah, okay.
This arrived, and I can't say what it is yet. I can't. This is here. I'll give you a clue. That's right.
It's a spaceship.
This is it. We had a mishap, and it started to fly away. Oh my gosh. Anyways, we have some equipment coming in. All right, what do you have?
I have this new feather because some people were asking, hey, you know, that's cool that you have lower radios, but I want to run more. Can we go to the overhead?
Oh, you want to go?
Yeah, I'm holding this thing. I want to have more memory and more data so I can do more with this radio. So there's a Feather M0, LoRa, and RFM. So we'll have a version of basically those feathers, but it has the Cortex M0 on there. For people who want 256K of flash and 32K of RAM and 48 megahertz, this will be available in a couple months maybe.
Okay.
For people who want to do a lot more.
Feather LoRa M0.
Yeah, I'm still like getting through the M0 versions. M0. Well, the 324 is just more supported, so I kind of like. Right. Yeah.
Good stuff. Okay. That was.
That's coming soon.
It's not out yet.
Don't ask.
Watch out, shiny thing. Woo! Zoom. Okay.
Zoom.
All right, let's.
I'm riding a gigantic dog.
Let's do questions, start loading them up, folks. Post them in the chat, we'll get them. We'll do a speed round.
Cool.
All right, we've got stuff going on here.
Yeah.
All right, is there an ebook version of the USB book?
I think there is, but there's a lot of diagrams, so I prefer the paper copy.
Okay, is there an IMU feather wing?
Not yet, because I'm still designing it, so totally no ETA.
Okay, in the US, should you use a 400 or 900 megahertz radio?
900 megahertz.
Okay, what's the difference between the new LoRa featherboards and the slightly older featherboards from, I think, last week?
Last week were non-LoRa radios, so they're a lot less expensive, but they don't have the patented LoRa technology that lets them go much, much further. So if you don't care about range, or its power is not as important, you aren't going that far, you're only going about 500 meters away, you can totally use the other ones. If you want to go much, much further, or if power is very important, so you want to be able to use less power to go the same distance, you might want to splurge on LoRa radio. So it's a trade-off. You get fancy radio or basic radio. Basic radio for a lot of people is perfectly fine. It depends a little bit about what your situation is.
Okay. Circuit Playground, I think we have a desk of Lady Ada that you can watch with the latest updates from our circuit board platform, our educational platform called Circuit
Playground. It's happening.
Yeah.
It's happening.
Can you use the radios like walkie-talkies?
No, they're not meant for audio. They're data packet radios. You could theoretically take audio and then transmit it very slowly over these radios, but they're just not high speed. They're only about like 20 kilobits per second, so you're not gonna get maybe 20 kilobytes. It's just not very, I think 20 kilobits per second is about the average. And you can always, you know, go up or down, but they're just not, they don't use amplitude or single sideband. They use FSK, so it's digital data, best used for small packets of data that you're sending, and then it does CRC on them and stuff. So yeah, I mean, you could do audio, but this is really not what they're meant for.
Okay, can the Minty Boost charge an iPad mini too?
No.
Would it be difficult to use the Feather M0 libraries on a Teensy 3.2?
They might. I mean, like, the most stuff that we write, if it will work on a Feather M0 and it works on Arduino, it'll work on a Teensy 3.2, but it's just not guaranteed and not tested. Paul has a list of all the Teensy 3.2 libraries that are tested. And if he does find a bug, you know, whatever, he'll usually submit a pull request, or somebody will, and we'll integrate it. I have already six platforms I'm supporting pretty actively. So knowing all the registers for every single one is a little bit challenging.
Do you want to make an M0 Funa Feather?
I do, but it's harder to route than I thought. I thought it was going to be like, ooh, a breeze, but it's taken me a while to get it routed, because I want it to be the same size.
What's your favorite design software? I'm going to assume they mean CAD stuff you like.
I use Eagle CAD.
Okay.
It's the best of the worst and the worst of the best.
Any plans to internationalize sales? Well, we have a couple thousand resellers. Go to adafruit.com/distributors and support your local reseller of Adafruit goods.
Yeah.
Okay. When is M0? Of course, then we ship worldwide most places. When is M0 a better choice? When a 32U4 is a better choice? Like, which one do you choose?
32U4 has more support. It's older, so there's a lot more example code, more libraries, a lot more things work for it. The M0 is a lot more powerful, but there's like a lot of things that are still being worked on, like PWM and apparently some interrupt stuff is not completely sorted out. Not a lot of libraries. If there's a lot of if there's low level stuff, it's not supported. Like, I'm still learning how to do deep sleep modes in M0. It's different than the 32U4. 32U4 is really easy. It's really well documented. The M0, you know, everyone's got to kind of start from the beginning and learn this new chip. It's a completely different architecture. So if your stuff works with it, that's great. But it's not guaranteed to work. It's a very new chip.
Yeah. Okay. That stuff. Do you have any recommendations for right angle mount NeoPixels?
No, wires? I don't know.
Yeah. What IDE do you use most?
I use XEMAX a lot. I'm trying to move on to Atom, but I still really just use XEMAX and make files.
Okay. What are your thoughts about a separate power rail for powering off portions of a board for ultra low power devices?
For the Feather, you know, it's tough because you have to balance usability. Like, it's like being able to shut off each section, it's like, well, you probably want something different. There's an enable pin. You turn off the enable pin, you shut down everything. So if you really want to, like, shut down the board, there is a, like, shut down thing. And if you really wanted to have the, the Feather, and you want it to only transmit once a day, and you want it to basically be, like, completely dead in between, you could have something, a very, very, very like a watchdog timer, an external watchdog timer chip that uses very little current that literally turns on and off the enable pin. The thing is that the things that you have to, like, I looked, and once you get to 300 microamps, half of that, or like 100 microamps of that, is the brownout detect. I'm not willing to turn that off. That's a safety feature. Turning that off just will end in tragedy, so I'm not willing to get rid of that. The watchdog timer has to be on. That's 25 microamps. The battery level monitor is 25 microamps. Like, if somebody really wants something super low power, they should probably take this board file, gut everything they don't need, and then just make it themselves. I want to have something that's very easy to use, and I'm willing to go pretty far and have it be low power, but it's just not a priority.
Okay, what IDE do you use the most when you code?
XEMAX.
Okay.
Hasn't changed in the last 2 minutes.
All right, where can someone get an I2C RFID reader module?
The PN532 that we stock is I2C compatible.
Okay. Will you be developing any API specifically for Lua on the ESP8266?
No.
Okay.
I'm not.
Yeah, it's fine. And with that, I think we got through a ton of them. Thank you, Lady Ada. Zoom. All right, it's time to give something away.
Okay.
Trivia question time.
Yay. I'm going to give away a copy of USB Complete because this book is so awesome.
Okay.
I think everyone should have it. So you, the viewer, will get this. You can only win one time per show if you've won before, and I know I'm going to be very upset, and don't do it. Let everybody have a chance to win a fabulous prize. This isn't gold bullion here. This is a book.
Yeah.
The first person to answer the question correctly in, I guess, Facebook, YouTube, or Twitch, wherever we see it. We'll do the best we can here. There's three streams to watch for.
Don't
be a dick.
So here's how we're going to do it tonight, because this is the first time we're broadcasting on Facebook, so facebook.com/AdafruitIndustries. The first person to type in a comment right now that says, I want this USB complete book, will get this. And so I'm just gonna.
They just have to say, I want the
USB
complete book.
Yeah, that's pretty much it. It's just it's perfect. You just have to go like, put this in my,
Want, eat, USB.
Yeah, so there was a couple comments before, but these were prior to this. This is a new comment right now.
As of now, on Facebook.
We have 138 viewers, so all you have to do is stop watching and then type in,
I want
this.
A copy of USB Complete.
Yeah, so let's see who, Maxine Gringas, congratulations.
Congratulations, Maxime.
Okay, great. Maxime, email support at adafruit.com and tell them you won the book.
Sweet.
You won. Email support at adafruit.com.
Nice work.
Yeah, it was that easy. It was that easy. All you had to do is be logged into Facebook. I guess that's the trick.
It's a great book, really. Yeah. I mean, it's so useful.
In other news, Facebook just acquired Adafruit.
Yes.
This is their new business model. They figured it out finally. Monetizing your high school friends doesn't work out long term. You have to figure out a way to give away USB books.
If you wonder the difference between CDC, HAD, mass storage,
yeah,
whatever, USB control, asynchronous, synchronous, J pulses, K pulses, it's all in there. Okay, I think that's it, right? We just have to show a photo of a cat.
Yeah, that's it. Thank you, everyone. We are viewer supported, so if you purchase something using the code Laura, you get 10% off. It's 10% less for us, but it still helps. All this video costs money. So all this stuff.
Yeah, you want me to like develop more feathers.
You want more feathers? You want more Lauras? You want more Laura feather?
What's
Laura
funny is
and zeros?
People have been asking for Laura for like a year, and I've been like, I'm gonna get to it real soon. And then like when we designed the feather, and I'm like, I can fit it on the feather. It's perfect because it's like all in one, battery charging, ready to rock. Yes.
Yeah. So thank you so much. Thank you all the Adafruit team members who are helping behind the scenes. All the folks that are here every single day who make Adafruit a great place to be. Thank you, Lady Ada, for building this thing.
Working out.
This is a cool business. Thanks everyone who supports Adafruit by purchasing stuff. This is the only way that we survive. This is it.
The only way we survive.
This is it. There's nothing else.
Okay.
I don't believe that we're employable besides doing this. I don't think.
Tough.
I think people, it's a novelty maybe at first, but then we show up every day.
And, I know.
And then you gotta feed us. And,
do you know how hard it is to design new hardware every single week? I design a new board every week. It has to work. It has to work for like hundreds of thousands of people.
Yeah.
It's a challenge. And then like the manufacturers, you don't understand what I have to go through to get them to ship me the thing that I ordered. Like it's really hard.
It's complicated. Okay, that's it. We'll see everybody next week. We have some shows between now and then. So tune in tomorrow for
Circuit Playground probably tomorrow, through Thursday.
Yeah, we got a lot of stuff going on.
All sorts of Tony Cola maybe streaming tomorrow.
Yeah, we got a lot of stuff going on.
Oh my goodness.
So thank you everyone. Here's a picture of a cat. And here is your moment of Zener. Bye-bye.